Hi guys, welcome to another episode of TinkChat. As you can see, this episode we have Eugene back with us.
Hi, it's good to be back. I mean, Nick wasn't so bad. You know, he showed us some really cool stuff, or talked about some really cool stuff about the film industry. So, well, glad to be back. Hopefully we'll have more of those interviewees joining us in the future.
Yep.
Cool. So, well, I guess what's the topic for today?
We are going to be talking about 3D printing in automotives.
Okay, but I think before we're getting there, we wanted to do a bit of a recap because a couple weeks ago we heard in Dubai they finished building the world's largest, I guess, structure, 3D printing.
Yeah, I think they said it was an office building.
Yeah, 6,900 square feet in 17 days. Of printing, and then the remainder 48 hours of actual finishing construction.
Yeah.
So the human labor portion got cut down by a significant amount.
Yeah.
Right. What was the cost of that?
I think it was almost $140,000 USD.
Oh.
So for a 6,900 square feet place, I think that's
pretty good.
Pretty good.
I would say sign me up. I mean, given the fact that we're in Vancouver.
Yeah.
I mean, the housing prices here are expensive. So, you know, knowing that technology like this is coming around, really cool, really awesome. We did hear that there was a significant cost reduction, though, both for, I guess, the parts and labor?
Parts and labor by 50%, and that's quite a bit.
That is quite a bit. So, I mean, imagine this home, if it's $140,000, what would it be normally? I mean,
we'll just double it, right?
Yeah, double it.
$280,000.
Or 50% of that, I suppose.
Yeah.
okay, I think, you know, that maybe we'll kind of jump back into that a little bit more. I mean, that's just one element of what we saw just recently, and I think there will be more of that as things develop.
Yeah.
I think I saw some photos of it. I'm pretty sure Andy will put some overlays here with regards to the house.
It looks pretty nice.
Yeah. They did actually, in fact, put rebars. I saw the photos. There were reinforcing bars actually inside the actual structure. Yeah. So it's not, you know, I'm assuming it's somewhat code, if not up to code.
Yeah.
So if it is up to code, then, I mean, yeah, that's what we need in order for that industry to really start adopting a technology like this. So I think that's really cool.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess let's go back to automotives.
Onto the topic of the day.
Yeah.
Automotives. There's a lot actually in this industry. I think way back in 2014, we started to see some, and then 2016 with local motors.
Yeah, local motors, and I guess their car is Strati.
Project car.
Project.
I think. Concept.
Concept car, prototype.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of other car manufacturers have come up with concept cars that are 3D printed, but I guess whether or not it was fully 3D printed wasn't just a render.
I think we have to keep in mind that 3D printing is used across industry for prototyping, and that still stays true today. So what we're talking about are kind of the more forward-thinking projects that are either, I wouldn't say one-offs, or at least they're concept ideas to really allow the industry to think about their approach to manufacturing their products. So yeah, Strati was a really cool product. Locomotives was a really cool company.
Yeah.
They were a company.
Arizona-based.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And this car was like a giant FDM printed.
Yes.
So FDM is just like any of the tabletop 3D printing technologies that you can find out there.
So you put plastic upon a layer of plastic building all the way up until you get your actual finished product.
Yeah, and instead of it being, you know, 0.3 millimeter diameter width, this thing is probably huge. Like 10 millimeters in terms of a single pass. So it's printing this giant object really quickly.
Yeah.
I think it was 45 hours.
Yeah, roughly around that.
To get this 75% of the body, I guess 75% of the car, which is mostly the body.
Yeah, well, the tires and the seats and everything weren't printed yet. Those were put in. But the main body frame of the car is 3D printed.
Yeah, and you mentioned that the aesthetics of the 3D printed layers was a bit of a turnoff for you.
Yeah, it was.
you know, the aesthetics portion of the vehicle, I mean, you get to see the layers, right?
Yeah.
They're really thick, they're really big. And they didn't post-process the final result.
Yeah.
I think there's a bit of a charm to that. You think slightly differently.
Well, there's gaps and holes. And it's just as a finished product, I was not very...
Well, I think, you know what? I think as a proof of concept, I mean, the 3D printed home will have those layers too. The cars will have those layers too. Consumer side, I can see it being something that not everyone will enjoy.
Yes. I mean, it doesn't take that long to post-process.
Right.
Those parts, I would guess.
Yeah. So they did think about some of the importance elements of what the body of the car is supposed to do. So it's supposed to protect the driver and the passenger. And so the material choice it did for Strati was a carbon fiber infused ABS material.
Yeah.
Printed via the FDM method. I don't know. I think it was a two-seater.
It was a two-seater.
A two-seater roadster type of
car. It was a convertible.
Yeah.
Well, I guess it was. It didn't have a roof, so no top.
Yeah. Speedster. We'll call it that. The electronics and the motors and everything got put in later. It was an electric vehicle, as far as I could understand. No combustion engine inside of PL or ABS printed.
I don't think you want that.
No, probably not. They were around in 2016.
Yeah.
We did a bit of research on Strati. I think the project is no longer around.
Yeah, I don't think so. I was reading up on Local Motors' website, and they actually haven't said anything about Strati ever since 2016.
So are they focusing on something else then?
They are. They're actually focusing on this new thing called Ollie, and it's like it's a bus. With no driver, so it's a
autonomous vehicle.
Yes, it's an autonomous vehicle that picks people up around like a campus kind of thing.
The project had some legs, but I think if they did some market research, I mean, there are individuals that love the aesthetics and that don't, and so maybe the market just simply wasn't big enough. But I think the idea of this 3D printed shell is not limited to just local motors. I mean, we talked about the 3D printed boat.
Yeah, the boat.
Which is the same concept. Mostly 3D printed actual structure, and then the electronics and the motors.
Everything was put in afterwards.
So, I think that idea, that concept will still stick around. Maybe a little bit of post-processing will make it go a little bit further in the consumer market in the long run.
Well, at least for consumers like me.
Right. I think I'll love it, but I wouldn't want to clean it. All the little crevices would be difficult.
Yeah, it would be.
they also
said that this 3D printing, even with FDM technology, in the article, it actually said that it could be stronger than what we have right now and safer for the drivers.
Yeah, I mean, like, carbon fiber is a very strong, I want to call it core material.
Yeah.
But
we know FDM structurally is not very strong
upon
impact.
I don't know what would happen in terms of regulations there was no crash test done on Strati, and so would it end up being shards of ABS flying towards the driver, or those are genuine questions that we as an industry need to think about. I mean, it's really great to push forward thinking and ideas, but I mean, we got to distill them back a little bit and think about people and how they're going to use it and all that stuff. So, that's Strati. We also did a whole bunch of research on, I want to call it surrounding infrastructure stuff.
Yeah.
So we found a company called HRE. They're a California-based company, and they make car rims.
Rims. Wheels.
And they had a project called HRE 3D Plus that they did in collaboration with GE Additive Works. Is that what they're called? I think they're Additive Works. And they built a multi-part rim that then got assembled into this final rim.
In a carbon fiber barrel.
Looking thing. Yeah. Really cool, though. I mean, the shapes, the form. I think they're more looking at it from a structural form perspective, because you actually couldn't achieve what they are trying to do with traditional manufacturing. The way that the actual structure weaved in and out, that would be really difficult, if not super costly, to do it through.
If you think about it, like, traditional manufacturing will be trying to shave off from a block of material, right?
Yeah.
And just from the interweaving, that would be very hard for a machine.
Well, even the turning of the actual part, getting the bit into spaces. I mean, they did point out the waste reduction of this wheel that they were building. It went from like an 80% waste out of a single block CNC subtractive wheel down to 5% waste. That's, and then even then, they recycled quite a lot of that.
That's quite a reduction.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think in a world of, like, you know, looking at our impact, companies can also utilize that to evaluate whether this process is worth going down.
Yeah.
And then, you know, if you look at the longer term of this technology and it's coming down in price, this then becomes viable for a lot of different components.
Yeah.
Not just this one-off concept wheel, which right now probably costs a ton.
Yeah.
But, you know, 10 years, 15 years from now, it won't be that expensive anymore.
Well, I mean, just from the it should go down in price if you think about it this way. The waste reduction got reduced from 80% to 5%. Wouldn't that also mean you can carve more than one amount of part from the same block of titanium material?
Well, I guess they're not really carving, right? They're powder materials, but they could recycle and they could reuse. And I mean, if the parts are super light and super well optimized for design, then they can actually get more
out of it. Yeah.
Yeah. So there's many ways to evaluate something like what HRE is trying to do with their product.
Yeah.
But it just requires a single person inside to think about some of these elements, right? And there isn't that many people that can and have really spent some time to think about it's a new field.
Yeah, it's a new field. It's hard to jump out of your comfort zone,
right?
And 3D printing technology, technically it's still new to a lot of people,
right?
A lot of designers still hasn't really taken it and put it into their workflow.
Yeah, it is a 25-year-old technology for some of them.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's only become
affordable in a couple of years.
Right. I think it's partially because of, I mean, the desktop push, for sure. But, I mean, if you think about how long it's taken for it to get here, there's just simply not enough professionals that really are in the industry that has either both touched the tech or come with a background that...
From that. Yeah.
And I think a partnership like what HRE did with G Additive Works is really smart.
Yeah.
Because it tapped into a group of people that understood the technology that they were using, which is, I think, EBM. So EBM technology, electro beam melting, I think it's what it's called, is very similar to sintering.
Yeah.
In that it uses like an energy source to melt powder.
Yeah.
Instead of a laser.
Okay. So they're relatively... They're basically the same, I would say.
Yeah, close enough. If we want to distill it down to like layman's terms, the end result of both is
the same.
Is similar, if not close to the same. And I mean, this thing was built of titanium.
Yeah.
Alloy of sorts. We don't actually know the formulation of it, but strong enough to withstand impacts on the road.
Yeah.
To hold up your car. And just forward pushing, right? Yeah. Carbon fiber barrel. I mean, this is a new. Potentially a new type of rim that we haven't seen before.
Well, also on the website, these rims were fitted on a McLaren.
Okay.
So
they're going on to really expensive vehicles.
I don't know if we'll ever see it in more common cars.
Right. Yeah.
But maybe in the near future.
Right. Okay, so kind of going from there, HRE doing the super cool titanium rims to a vehicle that we found. I think they're down in California, maybe the US somewhere.
Yeah.
They're called Czinger, and they make a hypercar.
Yeah, they made a hypercar. Yeah. $17 million.
1.7.
Oh, 1.7. Oh, my bad.
They're 1.7. And it's actually, they didn't do fully 3D printed for everything. They picked and chose what would work for them. And most of the actual 3D printing was done on the subframe.
Yeah.
So, you know, they utilized both carbon fiber rods, extruded aluminum rods, titanium, 3D printing. And they picked and chose where it was best utilized. So a lot of it was in the suspension linkage. And so if you look at some of the linkage that they've actually done, it was like really super organic.
Yeah, it was very organic.
And, you know, those were mostly out of aluminum. Mm-hmm. Some parts were out of titanium, yeah, where it was needed. They chose the material for the application.
Yeah.
And, a lot of it was also done via computers.
Yes.
So,
well, the first prototype is still drawn by a designer. Mm-hmm. And then afterwards, they utilized the computers to actually, they set like values for it, what they wanted. So then the computer would generate a new model that would reduce the amount of materials used, reduce weight and everything. So it came up with a more organic design.
Yeah.
I think they called it a bionic design, right?
Yeah. Well, bionic design, generative engineering, biomimicry,
yeah,
all based around the idea of following what Mother Nature has done for the last X amount of years, billions of years, and looking at our bone structures as an inspiration for how to optimize for strength and weight.
Yeah.
And so, you know, what you just talked about of an engineer or a designer designing it by hand, mm-hmm, they took everything they learned about what the structure should look like and should do, and then they fed it into this generative engineering software that spat out.
Yeah.
A design that was similar but really, really optimized based on the load that it was going to see.
Yeah. One thing that scared me was they were talking about the process of making that part was at the start it took 2 weeks for a team of people, mm-hmm, to come up with a design. And then afterwards, with the main design, the computer took 2 minutes to come up with the final product.
Right.
That had the weight reduction, the material reduction, everything like that. And it was just scary.
I think it's really cool though. I mean, you know, talk about looking for optimizations and efficiencies in business.
Yeah.
I mean, there's always this talk about, are we going to, you know, kill jobs?
Yeah.
Right? Are these advanced technologies going to remove jobs? And I think the better mindset and the mind frame to get into a topic like this is it's actually shifting the job market from something that is more labor intensive, mm-hmm, to something that is more creative and about what humans are really good at.
Yeah,
which is that inherent nature of the mind that we have allows us to, you know, create innovations that we've never seen before.
Creativity.
And then letting the tools that we have access to help us get there quicker and innovate faster, right? Uh-huh. And so, while for some I definitely agree it's scary, my job is on the line due to these, you know, software that's gonna, you know, do optimization, mm-hmm, for me. But that just means you can actually spend more of your time
creating
the creation, so you actually get to do more creation and less on, mm-hmm, the actual physical thing.
Yeah.
So I think that's smart. I think that the company actually had an initiative at the beginning, or at least at the end of their, mm-hmm, vehicle, to get the car's weights down to the same as the power output of the vehicle. So this kind of magical number in the vehicle or the automotive industry of 1-to-1 weight ratio is magical, supposedly. Mm-hmm. And they did through optimizations and choices of material and the fabrication process using 3D printing. They got the power to weight ratio down to 1-to-1. So 1,250 kilograms to 1,250 horsepower in the vehicle. I mean, that's astounding. Mm-hmm. If you think about vehicles of normal prices, I mean, they're 300.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
And they're 3,000 pounds.
Yeah.
This thing is a lot lighter and a lot more powerful.
Powerful, yeah.
Yeah. But this is a hypercar, so, you know, $1.7 million, I assume.
Yep.
we may not see that technology trickle down yet.
Yeah.
Or maybe ever.
Or maybe in the near future.
I would love to see a generative design vehicle, though, again, aesthetics will come into play at that point.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll find some stuff. Maybe we can find some stuff that showcases that. We'll think about it.
We'll look into it.
Bugatti. Some of you guys may know about the company. Bugatti is a vehicle manufacturing company. I think they also do like jet engines or sort of airplane engines.
Yeah.
But Bugatti, the actual car division, maybe that's a better way to put it.
The car known to have 1,000 horsepower.
Yeah. the fastest car at some point in the history of automobiles. Yeah. They also did a project on 3D printing with around the brake calipers, so the thing that actually stops your vehicle.
Yeah.
Was it for weight reduction? I think there's probably a certain element of weight reduction, cooling.
Yeah, and cooling.
So in high performance vehicles, cooling is a significant component of the car's performance. And if you use your brakes too much, you get a thing called brake fade.
Yes.
And so that means your brake stops working.
Yeah. So when you're stepping on it, you're like, I'm not slowing down.
Yeah. And so more cooling to the brakes, the better it is. And so, you know, if you look at your car, a lot of the times the actual brakes are covered in this giant metal clam on the shell of a design. If you can actually allow more air to get to it, the faster it cools down, the more performance.
Yeah. So this one was designed by Bugatti to, I guess, repeatedly stop the car from triple digit speeds. Yeah. Cooling down was a huge factor for him.
Yeah.
Looking at the shape and the design of it, it's very similar to what we saw in the
Czinger.
Yeah.
With their suspension components.
Yeah.
Yeah. They were very careful in material selection, though, because brakes go through really high temperatures when you're going from, you know, 300 kilometers down to zero.
Yeah, you need a really strong material.
Yeah, so they chose titanium. Again, titanium alloy. We don't know which alloy they chose exactly for its heat resistance and lightness.
Yeah.
And then they, again, use biomimicry and or bionic design generative engineering. We don't really know which one they
picked.
For getting that organic shape, they dictated the shape, maybe the stress points, and then they put the load on the part inside simulation, and then the software did all the
design work
for optimizing. I think the time it took to print was also really, really quick. Like 45
hours. Actually, I don't know. I don't know, actually. How long does it actually take to create a brake caliper today?
Like, well, it depends. I think high performance vehicles, the ones that utilize, there's a brand out there called Brembo. You know, they have casted single piece aluminum or even billet aluminum machined.
Yeah.
So all that machine time, I mean, probably the Bugatti ones took longer, to be honest. I think
It's a prototype, so.
Well, concept prototype. Yeah, it's actually usable. They did fit it onto retail cars. Actually, it's, you know, it's gonna cost really, really
expensive. Well, I'll just show you a video of it being tested.
Yeah, it's pretty. I mean, crazy to see the sparks coming out. Yeah. But from a cost perspective, I don't think they are going to come out winning. with regards to the sheer volume of calipers that they're going to be building. But also just the technology they're choosing and what they're trying to do. And also the actual brand value of said vehicle. Yeah. It's just not going to be a cheap caliper you can buy off the shelf to put into your car if you like the design and looks, right? But I would say 45 hours is reasonable.
Well, I if you think about it, it's less than 2 days for a brake caliper.
I mean, if you think about it from a prototyping perspective, 45 hours for a turnaround. To test your concept, and then to be able to do that multiple times if you failed the first design.
Normally back then versus 2 weeks.
2 weeks, 3 weeks, retooling.
Yeah, and then retooling probably another 2 weeks.
Yeah.
I guess, if you think about it that way, 45 hours for a brake caliper, a working brake caliper is actually pretty fast.
It is. Yeah. I mean, there is something to be said about efficiency in turnaround in business, right? And I mean, if we can all get to innovation faster, and we can then get to market faster, there's a win across the board for the business.
Yeah.
Right. So, I think we're seeing a ton of these little projects inside every industry.
Yeah.
Automotive is a natural fit. I think I have a good friend go to the Ford production plant, and he got to see them use the carbon 3D printers, and you know, they were printing manifolds and intake manifolds.
Oh, wow.
Actually fitting them into the cars.
Uh-huh.
And so, you know, this thing is starting to trickle into things that we may touch on a day-to-day basis. Yeah. But what we talked about, I think, were more concept-ish projects. But having said that, Czinger is selling their vehicles.
Yeah.
Right? Bugatti is putting it into their cars.
Yeah.
So, you know, they are a little bit more luxury in terms of price point today.
Yes.
but as technology gets better, faster, cheaper, we will start to see some of that in our hands.
Yeah. Well, I think right now, just from all these examples that we just talked about, 3D printing and design thinking really go hand in hand.
No, right? Every single one of those organizations had one person who could think outside the box, if not a group of people.
Yeah.
Right. Every single organization had a person or a group of people that understood the capabilities of 3D printing. And then if they didn't, they accessed a group of people that did.
Mm-hmm.
So,
but the process of design thinking is still there.
Right.
That's right. They have to ideate, they have to create the prototype, test it out.
Well, even just imagining beyond what they have today.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, design thinking is one of those things where you think about what challenge you're trying to tackle.
Yeah.
And you're trying to go beyond what we have now, right? And that allows for, well, really great ideas. Mm-hmm. I mean, the heat problem for brake calipers has been around for decades.
Yeah.
And, you know, it took somebody at Bugatti to think about, well, we can open up and make a whole bunch of pores around the brakes
to
help cool it.
Yeah.
But we also can't lose rigidity, right? And so the constraints were built around it,
mm-hmm.
the project, and then they went and executed on that. And that's what design thinking does for you.
Yeah. Which is, I think it's perfect with 3D printing.
Well,
the 3D printing technology.
The technology lends itself to agility, right?
Yeah.
And design thinking, it's all about agility.
Yeah.
So trial, test until you get to
a final product where you solve your solution.
That's right.
You solve your problem.
That's right.
Yeah. Well, that's everything we have for today. We actually have more topics regarding the automotive industry, but we'll probably talk about it next episode.
A couple episodes later.
Yeah. We were going to be talking about motorcycles,
mm-hmm.
3D printing and motorcycles. But we'll leave this episode with just cars this time.
Yeah, I think it would have otherwise gotten too long.
Yeah.
We'll bring the motorcycle aspect of the automotive industry into play in another episode.
Yeah.
And if you enjoyed this one, let us know in the comments below.
Mm-hmm.
If you have comments or topics that you want us to explore,
let us know as well. Yeah. So if you enjoyed it, remember to subscribe with the red button below and click the bell button so that every time we release an episode, you'll be the first one to find out. And if you don't have time to watch a video, you can also listen to our podcast on Anchor and Spotify.
Right.
They're both free. So, yeah.
I think that's it.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for joining us today.
Yeah.
Or, yeah.
Next time.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.